Before I get started, since I'm the king of segues, you know, so smooth, I just got to like say it because I'll just forget. So I'm just going to say it now. Today's Uncle Roger's birthday. Hi, Roger.
Happy birthday.
So, I don't know what you think about what you just saw, like on that video. Some of you probably really like it. Some of you probably feel like it's stung in a place that you didn't like. You may disregard the video. You can do that if you choose. I'm going to spend the next hour supporting that, not with my opinion. I'm going to support it with the Word of God. If I love you, and I do, then I want to, I don't want to put something before your eyes that you'll absorb because it's spoken from the mouth of a famous man. I want to support everything that comes from this stage with God's Word. And then I want you to take that challenge. I want you to take that Word, and I want you to go home, and I want you to graze on that. Right? I'm a pig. I eat a lot, as you can tell. And sometimes I eat so fast that it's gone before my wife is like started. Right? Am I the only man? Right? Okay, there's another one, Mike, right? Carl? All right. Yeah, she's pointing right. Sometimes it's like I didn't even taste it, right? I think it was good. Honey, was that good? I think so. I don't know. You know, like you bite it off with the front teeth and then it's just boom, gone. But like, how do you properly digest a meal, right? You bite it with your front teeth, right? And then you put it in the back and you chew on it. So that's really what I want you to do. And that's what I did this week. I chewed on God's Word and I want to share it with you. I want to stretch you. I want to challenge you. When God laid it on my heart to start this church, he certainly did not lay out of my heart to start a church where there'd be a little group of people and we would sing Kumbaya and we'd have little Christmas parties and we'd have a nice little congregation that we could all gather around, like the Rotary Club. Like, that's not what God wanted. I think that God wanted something different. I think that he wanted our church to be a church that would impact the world, that would reach the ends of the earth with the gospel. That's what's on Jesus' heart, so that should be on ours. Every church, that's what should be on your radar. The end of the earth, right? And so that's what I want to do, and I think that that only gets accomplished if you really chew on God's Word and let it really speak to you and change you and stretch you and get you out of your comfort zone to do that. Now, this guy up here, Francis Chan, was he stretching people?
Yes.
Telling you that you should put the kingdom of God first before your family, and like, that's crazy. He talked about an Americanized Christianity rather than America that's influenced by Christianity. We're unfortunately often a Christianity that's influenced by America, and I love this country, and I'm not here to put it down in any way, but as citizens of the kingdom of heaven, that must be your first allegiance. Okay. And so I want to stretch you, and I want to preach to you tonight from God's Word. And we've been going through the Gospel of Luke to carefully determine who Jesus Christ is. That's what Luke did. He put together this gospel for this guy Theophilus to understand the truth of who Jesus Christ is, because Jesus said, you know, in the Word, it says that he wants us to worship in spirit and in truth. And so we got to be stockpiled on truth, because until we know who Jesus Christ really is, we can't worship him correctly, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, you can shout out here, it's cool. Yeah, right? So if we're going to get fired up about who Jesus Christ is, we have to know who he is. And so we want to know some truth. But now, tonight, not so much who Jesus is, but more what Jesus taught, okay? And that'll help us to learn to worship him, and we will learn the truth. And our dish tonight, our dish will be in Luke chapter 9, so I want to encourage you to grab a copy of God's Word. They're all over. You haven't read it so many times that you don't need to look at it again. I haven't. You haven't. Nobody has. And so I encourage you to grab a copy of God's Word. They're all over the place. They're blue. They're, if you don't have one, if you don't own one, just go ahead and take it. It's our gift to you. Open it up to Luke chapter 9. And I don't always title the message, but this night our message is called, That's a Tall Order. And I think having watched that video, you kind of understand where I'm coming from. That's a tall order to do what he said. And so I want to read verses 21 through 27 with you, and then we'll go from there. So let's bite it off with our front teeth. You guys, are you paying attention? Okay. I'm going to wait for our new friend here to get there. I don't want to go ahead of you. I want to wait on you so you can read with us. I'm not going to. All right, well, I'm going to read it out loud then. All right, so just listen carefully, all right? Chapter 9, starting in verse 21. Jesus warned his disciples not to tell anyone who he was. The Son of Man must suffer many terrible things, he said. He'll be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of the religious law. He'll be killed, but on the third day, he'll be raised from the dead. Then he said to the crowd, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross daily, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world, but are yourself lost or destroyed? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory and in the glory of the Father and the holy angels. I tell you the truth, some standing here right now will not die before they see the kingdom of God. Okay, so leading up to this section of scripture right here where Jesus is speaking, it's right there in red. He's speaking to his disciples. He's speaking to a crowd of people. He always gets a big crowd, right? And so before he's speaking to these people, to get the context of where this is coming from, just think back over the weeks that we've gone through Luke. You see God just doing amazing things as Jesus is performing miracle after miracle, right? He's preaching with authority. Like, these people have never heard anyone speak like with such authority than Jesus Christ did. He's performing miracle after miracle. He's talking to the storms like they were singing here. The wind and waves still know his name. He speaks to the storm and it stops. He's raising dead people. He's casting out demons. He's forgiving the sin of a prostitute right in front of people. He told his buddies, his disciples who are fishermen, who had been fishing all day with no catch, the experts on the Sea of Galilee, the fishermen, hey, I know you caught nothing, but go ahead and cast your net out on this side over here and see what happens. And they put the net in, and what happens? There's so many fish in the net that they can hardly bring the net in, that the net begins to bust. He's healing the paralyzed guy who's lowered down through the roof of the house. You remember all these stories. This is what Jesus Christ has been doing leading up to this text right here. And so Jesus kind of looks at all these people. He basically says this, like, based on all that you've seen, based on all that you've heard, who do you say that I am? We talked about this last week. And the crowds, they have a variety of different answers, right? You're John the Baptist, or you're this, or you're Elijah, or you're one of these other prophets that had been raised from the dead. They knew he was someone special, but they didn't quite understand who he really was. But then he turns his attention to his disciples. Who's a Christian in here? Raise your hand. Come on now. Be loud and proud, right? That's good. So he's looking at you. He turns away from the evangelistic thing out there trying to get people saved. And he's looking at the Christians and he's like, listen, I understand what they say, but let me ask you a question. Who do you say that I am? And so Peter, being the mouthpiece of the disciples, he answers correctly. He says, you are the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one, the one who's been fully consecrated for this task to reach the lost, to set the captives free. You're the one who's going to do this. You're the Son of the living God. He got it right. He got it right. See, they all knew that there was going to come a day that this Messiah, this mighty one, would show up on the scene and deliver them from Roman oppression. And so they're like, oh, finally, Our guy's here. The cat's out of the bag. This is him. This is our guy. Awesome. And so his identity, or at least what they thought, his identity has been established. His title has been established. His position as Messiah has been established. It's a done deal. This is it. And so he gathers them around. He's like, all right, now listen, you're right. That's who I am. I'm the guy that you've been waiting for. Now huddle up, everyone. Huddle up. And he gathers his disciples around, and he's like, all right, listen, yeah, I'm the guy, all right? And like a quarterback does, right? He gathers them around. He's like, all right, here's the plan. Here's the plan that you guys have been waiting for all this time. This is how it's going to work. Your Messiah is here. You guys excited? Yes. Here's how it's going to happen. Don't tell anyone who I am. Can you see the first person, the head pop up out of the huddle? And he gives them like the people's eyebrow, like the rock, like, what do you mean, don't tell anyone who I am? You're supposed to be the Messiah. You're the one who's going to be this strong conqueror, and it's going to be a big thing. We're going to win, right? How do you be famous and win if you won't let me tell anyone who you are? Like, that doesn't seem to make sense. But the plan begins to unravel here. He says, don't tell anyone who I am. I'm going to suffer. And then I'm going to be rejected by all those religious leaders that you know and respect and love, and they're going to have me murdered. You see the heads popping up out of the huddle, like, what is this guy? You had us fooled. You said you were the guy, and now you're saying this? Like, that would not be my plan. How can you be a strong and mighty deliverer if you're going to die? No, Jesus, you don't, I guess you don't understand how this works, Jesus. They're supposed to die, not us, not you. Like, can you sense it, right? That's just not right. Oh, but I'm going to rise from the dead. Ready, break. What? Are you kidding me? That's your plan, Jesus. 3 years, and we've been following you, and this is your stupid plan. In the Matthew account, it actually says that Peter, having told Jesus that he's the Son of the living God, took Jesus aside and said, here, come here, Jesus, a second. Yeah. And it says that he reprimanded. Yeah, that's a really stupid plan, Jesus. Okay, he's the Son of God. You don't reprimand the Son of God. That's a really bad plan, right? But that's what Peter did. So anytime you think someone's real stupid, they're not as stupid as him. So we give him grace. See, we celebrate the resurrection every year. We celebrate Easter all the time, and we can look back and we can see what happened. We can see this plan that he said and go, oh, yeah, it worked out. It worked out well. He actually did. He rose from the grave. That's awesome. And now he's building his church, and now it's 2 billion strong worldwide. Like, it's working. But these guys, right, they didn't have Easter hindsight. They had no idea. They couldn't fall back on anything, but let me tell you what they did have. What these guys did have is that hundreds and hundreds of years earlier, this guy named Daniel, this prophet, he prophesied, he predicted this thing. Under the influence of God, he said that there was going to be this mighty Messiah. This anointed one would come, and he would rule eternally. That's good, right? But that he would die having appeared to accomplish nothing. Like, hindsight, right, for us, the Easter celebrators, we're like, yeah, that's a perfect fit, right? But for the disciples, what? I mean, I can't even fathom what they're thinking at this time, right? They put all their, and this is an Easter joke, but they put all of their eggs in his basket, right? And now it seems to be an apparent failure. For us, it's probably a little bit easier to say, yeah, it worked out pretty well. It is well with my soul. So he tells his team the play, right? And but that's only the first half of the play. The first half of the play is, don't tell anyone who I am. I'm going to suffer, and I'm going to die, and I'm going to raise from the dead. And that's kind of shocking, but he lets them know the second half of the play. And that part of the play is not so much what he's going to do. Now he's talking about you. And this is the part that really hits home, because you can't change what Jesus is going to do. But you can make a decision of your will what you're going to do. And so this part has to do with you. He says, after he shocks them with this insane plan, years and years of following him, a couple years now, like 3 years of following him, and he's performing miracles, and he's the Son of the living God, and you're the Christ, you're the anointed one, you've come to deliver us, and now this, but it all culminates to this. I'm the guy, and this is my plan, and if you really want to follow me, this is what it is. And he's talking to the people, and that's just like I'm talking to you right now. He says to the crowd of people, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross daily, and follow me. What? What in the world is that? What does that even mean? Was Jesus asking them to literally die? Like, you know, there's some that will say on that day, the day of the Lord, Lord, Lord. And he'll say, who are you? Like, some people aren't going to get in. And so he's like, if you want to follow, if you want to really be an authentic, real follower, like, if you really want in, you got to turn away from your selfishness and you got to pick up your cross daily and follow me. Well, does that mean I literally have to do what you did? Do I have to die? Well, maybe. And some do, even to this day, all across the world, they die because they're Christians and they say so, and they die because of it. There's a gentleman, his name was Dietrich Bonhoeffer. He was a pastor, a Lutheran pastor, back in the 30s, early 40s. He's over in Germany, and he was a huge opponent of Nazi Germany and outspoken about it. And he said something. He wrote books, and he preached. But the most famous saying of his life was this: when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. Well, little did he know that when he wrote that in 1943 he would be arrested by Nazi Germany, put into a concentration camp, and on April 9th of 1945, he was executed. He did. He died. But what does it really mean to follow Christ? What does it mean to be a true Christian? What does it mean to come and die? Does that mean I'm supposed to die, like literally die, dead, physically dead? That to be an authentic follower of Christ, I have to be a martyr? Does it mean that I'm to be good? No more drinking and no more smoking and no more cussing and don't chase men and women around and don't do all those things? Is it to follow Christ, does that mean I should put a Bible on the front dashboard of my car so I'm always following him? A lot of people do that. Does it mean that I'm supposed to go to church? Does it mean I have to be a Republican? Does it mean I have to make a daily verse come on my phone and that means I'm a Christian? Well, those might be things that Christians do for sure. But that doesn't necessarily mean that you're an authentic follower of Christ. That's not the tall order that I speak of here tonight. It's not the tall order that Jesus speaks of in the Word of God. Let's talk about the tall order of what it means to be an authentic follower of Jesus Christ. But first he said you have to turn from your selfish ways. And you guys probably all know, if I say this, is there someone in your life that is like blatantly selfish? Like that's all they can think of is themselves. They're completely self-centered. Don't yell out any names because they may be sitting in the room. Good call, Jared. He just went. He's got lots of family members here, so it could, yeah. And his mom's saying that and Ken's saying that, we're all saying that. You got them all fooled, Jared. but listen, there's people that are blatantly selfish. Like, it's visible. It's right there on their sleeve. They're just self-centered. That's all they can think of is themselves. Like, there's that person, you know, turn away from your selfish ways. I get that. But this is to the more subtle selfish person. Because not everybody is blatantly, outgoingly, I'm it, I'm everything, and you're nothing. Like, there's not a lot of those people around, but there's lots of people. I would venture to say that it's every single person that is subtly selfish. And I'll just say this, that anything that places yourself at the center and anything that places you at the top of the list must die to be a Christian. Every single thing. My preferences, my philosophy, my taste, my perspectives, my way, my style, my, me, I. All about me. And I'll just tell you that Jesus Christ makes it very, very clear about what he thinks about me stuff and its place in the life of an authentic follower of Christ. If you just look over to your right a little bit in the scriptures, you'll see verse 57. We're going to just start there. Jesus is talking about this stuff right here, right now. It's not my opinion, and I'm telling you, this is the stuff right here that will sting you, that will stretch you, and it might keep you from coming back here. But I love you so much, I'm going to share what it says. Because it is my desire, and I know that it's Jesus' desire, that you would be authentic followers of Jesus Christ. Not just by name, not just because you have one of these on. Okay? There's a lot of people. Do you ever watch TV with people have these on and go, what in the world? And you want to reach on that TV and rip that chain right off their neck, right? So some of you might be those people right here, right now. I might be that person because the standard of authenticity is right here in the scriptures, not me, okay? And not you for sure, all right? So let's just read this here. It says in verse 57, as they were walking along, so Jesus is walking and people are following him all the time. He can't get a moment alone. Someone says to Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. And that's what he's talking about here, right? Anyone wants to be my follower has to do these certain things, right? And so this guy says, or this gal says, I don't know who it is, it says, I will follow you. I'll follow you wherever you go. I will be a follower of yours. And so Jesus replies, foxes have dens to live in. And birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to even lay his head. He said to another person, come follow me. And the man agrees. But he says, Lord, put on the brakes. Right? Easy, Lord. Easy. Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. But Jesus told him, let the spiritually dead bury their own dead. Your duty is to go and preach about the kingdom of God. Another said, yeah, you think no one would offer at this point. I'd be like, yeah, I'm done with that, right? I can't even bury my dad. Right? So, but someone else comes forward anyway. Another says, yes, Lord, I'll follow you. Put the brakes on. But first, let me say goodbye to my family. But Jesus told him, anyone who puts a hand to the plow and then looks back, is not fit for the kingdom of God. Let me just start here. This whole thing about foxes with dens and birds with nests and the Son of Man doesn't have that. He's got no place to lay his head. Don't let this fool you, or don't let anyone fool you into slipping into this poverty gospel that says that if you want to be a real Christian, you can't have a place to rest your head, that you can't have a decent home, that you can't have anything nice. Like, that's not what it says. Because, see, Jesus didn't have those things. But the scriptures say if riches increase, don't set your heart upon them. But the Bible also says that every good and perfect gift comes from above. And what do you have that you have not received? So if riches increase, where'd that come from? Come on, point where it comes from, right? So that doesn't mean you have to be broke with no, you have to be homeless. It doesn't say that, right? It doesn't say that. It also says in the Old Testament early on, I want to say it's Deuteronomy, I am the Lord thy God who teaches thee to profit. So he's not saying you have to be completely broke. But what he is saying is this. Are you willing to forsake those things for my kingdom to advance? Are those things in the way of you getting out and preaching the kingdom? priority only. That's what we're talking about here. We're talking about priority. My needs, my comforts, my stuff, the things that I think that I need, self-imposed, culturally imposed standards that are not from the Word of God. Do you need them, or are you willing to let them go? That's what he's asking. Will you let them go for my sake? Because sometimes when you, and I've had this discussion with some of my dear friends in this church, sometimes if you have too much, you don't own that stuff. It owns you. And you gotta work like a dog to pay for this stuff rather than what this bumper sticker I saw one time. It said, live simply that others might simply live. Like if you don't have so much, maybe you could give a little bit so we could help someone, right? Not bad. Good idea. That might be the only thing you need. So how about this next thing here? So foxes have dens and birds have nests. And are you willing to let the things go that you think you need? Since this other person, come follow me, the man agreed, and he said, Lord, first let me return home and bury my father. This speaks of our responsibilities and our perspectives on things. We feel as though that it's, this guy did too, it's my responsibility. That's my dad. I'm supposed to go and take care of this thing, right? It makes sense to me. If your dad dies, you should go do that. It makes sense, right? That just speaks of these things. Like, and here's the thing that Jesus is telling him here. Jesus is very, very bold, a lot more bold than I. Pray for his boldness. He says, let the spiritually dead bury their own dead. Watch this. Look at his choice of words. Your duty. How much of that is preached in church? Grace, 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 grace. Yes, we can't be saved except by his grace. Like, there's nothing you can do. But how about this, Christian? It's your duty. It's not like, you know what? If you have time on Thursday, go tell someone about me. No, it's your duty. That's why he saved you. He's invested in you. He put his Holy Spirit in you. That's not for waste, so you could take it to your grave. No, so you can go give it to someone else. And it's not an option. It's your duty. It's your duty, right? Work. Work. He says it's your duty to go and preach about the kingdom of God. And so we balance that with our responsibilities that we think that we need to take care of and our perspectives. And it's all he's saying is, are you willing to let those things go for me? Here's the last one here, and this is the hardest one. He says... This guy says, a guy, gal, yes, Lord, I will follow you, but, see, there. Can I just tell you something? There's just no room for but. There's just no room for but. I'm going to talk about this in a little bit, but there's no room for but. There's no room for, yes, Lord, but. There's no such thing. The word Lord and but can never go in the same sentence, because if there's a but in the sentence, he's not your Lord. It's just the way it is. You guys can clap for Jesus. It's okay. And so he says this, picture it. Anyone who puts his hand to the plow, so he said a moment ago that it's your duty to go preach the kingdom, right? That's the work of the kingdom. So imagine yourself on the plow. All right, Lord, I'm in. And I put my hand to the plow. They didn't have plows like they have now. You get behind the ox and they get the thing and you're holding on to it. And he says, anyone who starts this and then stops to, he says, you're not even fit for the kingdom. Like Jesus is, he's got a standard, man. he's not lax and he's not weak in his delivery. Like if you even turn back, you're not even fit for heaven. Like, stay out. High standard, right? Yeah. So the thing is here is this third one is about your family. Is it good for a husband to care for his wife and his children? Yeah. Yes. Is it good for him to provide? Is it good for the wife to love and encourage her husband and take care of her children? All these, I mean, aren't we supposed to? If a man doesn't take care of his family, what does it say? He's worse than like an infidel? Like that That's awful, right? I don't want to be that guy. We're supposed to love and care for our family. We're supposed to teach them about the Lord. We're supposed to discipline them in the Lord. We're supposed to do this, right? It's important, right? Tell someone, it's important. It's important. However, are you willing to even put that group of people in second place to Jesus Christ? That's a huge tall order, man. That's a massive tall order. But that's what he's asking us to do. Don't look at Caleb. Caleb's not preaching God's word. Caleb's cuter than me. He's got Cheetos, but we want to pay attention to the Lord's word. Amen. Preach it, brother. So are you willing to put your family in its proper place? Not to cast it aside, but to put it in the proper place. See, Jesus makes it quite clear that an authentic follower of his no longer has self at the center, but their identity and their purpose have shifted to Jesus Christ and his purposes, his mission, which is to build his church. That's his priority, and the true authentic follower of Christ, that's his or her priority. Number one, above everything else, above what you think you need, above your responsibilities that you think you have, above what other things that people have imposed upon you, and even above your family. How does that look like horizontally right here with people, right? What that looks like is Philippians 2:4. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. I like the word also better. Take an interest in others also. So very much like the foxes have dens and the birds have nests, don't slip into poverty gospel. The same is here. Like, don't slip into, I suck, I don't need anything, I have to give everything away that I have so that other people, because they're more important than me, so I should starve so you can eat T-bone steaks every day. Like, that's not Christianity either. He says to not look out for your own interests only, but to look at others as well. Also, right? Don't just live in your little bubble like Francis said. Be thinking, there's a lost and hurting world out there. They're going to go to hell unless you tell them otherwise. Your God's only plan for salvation for people is your mouth. You got to be thinking about this, right? You got to be thinking about this when you go build a bridge, don't you? You got to go think about this when you're cutting grass. You got to go think about this when you're cutting grass. You got to go think about this when you're cutting grass. Is everybody cut grass in here? Whatever you do, when you're building something, Jesus. Tell your employees about Jesus. Tell your customers about Jesus. If they fire you, ooh, what's the big deal? Some people are dying because they tell them about Jesus. You ain't going to get, unless they might pull a gun out and shoot you. You get to be in glory. Hallelujah. Amen. Just tell people about him, right? That's what you're supposed to do. That's what, see, and you might say, well, that's kind of radical. No, that's supposed to be typical. Amen. I'm not saying anything that's like reserved for the elders and deacons and preachers and evangelists and stuff. That's for everyone. We're a holy nation of priests. We do different things in the body, but there's one spirit in us. And there's one task at hand, and that's to go tell the world about Jesus Christ. That's it. So it looks like that horizontally, but now vertically, right? Vertically. It looks this way. This way is Romans 12:1. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you. Do you hear Paul? He's pleading. He's not just suggesting. He's not saying, hey, this might be a good idea. He's like, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all that he's done for you. Think about that for a second. If you could just pause there for a minute. Think of all that he's done for you, right? Saved from yourself. Saved from the power of the enemy for your final verdict that you'd have to go to hell, but you don't have to anymore. That's amazing, right? I love that. I also get all my best friends, all of you guys, like, that's awesome. He provides for my family. I get to eat. I get to take a shower. I live in a house, like, I have the most amazing house. Some people have much nicer houses than me. But I used to live in my Nissan Sentra. So sometimes I walk up to my house and I'm like, What? It's like Caesar's palace to me. There's no way I get to live in this thing. I posted it the other day just because I couldn't stink and believe I could live there. That was the only way I could get it out. Like, I can't believe I get to live here. Some people would be like, that's like their shed. But to me, I can't believe it. I'm so blessed. So because of all that he's done for me, he goes on, he says, let them, your bodies, your life, be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind that God will find acceptable. Some translations would say it's your reasonable worship. I love that. I love the Bible, man. It's just so brutal. It's your reasonable worship. It's like Jesus is like, you know what? I want more than that, but I will settle for every bit of you. Right? It's your reasonable worth it. So you think about the reasonable worship. Think about scales. And on this, you know those old-fashioned scales? And they get the little trays with the chains and the little thing in the middle, right? So imagine on this side, all that God has done for you. Right? Anyone breathing? Right? Anyone eating Cheetos? Anyone even happy right now? Did you conjure that one up? No. Anyone have any friends in this world? Anyone got any kids that are beautiful? Awesome, right? You get to live in this country. It's awesome. How about the weather today? Anyone see the sunset I posted yesterday? Off the chain, dude. Crazy. How many sunsets did you make? Zero. It's all from him. So you take that scale, right? And it's like, wham! But reasonable, like he says, like to kind of say thank you for all of this, I'll take everything that you are. That might cut it. But not really, but it's reasonable. I'll settle for that. Give me everything. Right? Give me everything. There's a song. We'll sing it here sometime. We've sang it before. We'll sing it again someday. It's from Hillsong. It's called Hosanna. It's a great song. And in this song, there's this line right there. And this sums it up perfectly. It says, break my heart for what breaks yours. And the underlined part, this is what it is. Everything I am. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. Let me ask you a question. Can you even sing that? See, we sing songs all the time. But can is that the everything I am for your kingdom's cause? Is that the longing and the lyrics of your heart? Can you sing that line with even this much authenticity? I can't. I don't know about you guys. You may be super holy, but I know I can't. I cannot sing that song. I can't anymore because I'd be lying. But that's what he's looking for. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. Every resource at your disposal. And don't be thinking, oh, they're asking for my, no. That's nothing. What is it that you have that you have not received? And why would you boast as if you have not received it? Every penny in your bank, every penny in your wallet is his. And that's not good enough. If you gave every single dime right now, wrote a check and said, pop it right in the plate, that's not even enough. Because on top of that, he wants all of your attention. And he wants all of your perspective to be completely on him. He wants all your time. And he said all these things, reasonable compared to this. I'll settle for all. The devil condemns, but the Lord convicts. Right? So the scriptures talk a couple times about how they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. See, we sing that song, but we're no, come on now, right? Nobody. I know some of you guys love Jesus, but no one on earth can sing that line with complete sincerity that everything I am is yours. But that's what he's shooting for. But do you feel shame about that? Because if you feel shamed that you're falling short of that, that's the enemy trying to ruin you. But if you feel convicted to soar higher and get there, that's the Lord bringing conviction up in your heart. And that's what he's looking for. Okay? That's what he's looking for from us. Can I show you guys something? It wasn't in my sermon, but can you look at Colossians 3:4, please? See, someone might be saying, as I'm saying these things, this tall order, it's my life and I'll do what I want with it and I'll give God what I want, you know, when I want to, and this enlightenment thinking that says that the center of the universe is yours truly. And I'll give God what I want to give because this is my life. Do you ever hear people talking about that? Like, I'm not being political here, but, you know, I can do with my body, the ladies would say. It's my body. It's my life. I'll do what I want with it. You've heard this on the news, right? You've heard this, okay? I just kind of stumbled upon this, but if you're a Christian, okay, that's a lie from hell. Look at Colossians 3, verse 4. Let me just start in 3. You ready? 3:3. For you died to this life, he's talking to Christians, and your real life is hidden in Christ, with Christ in God. And listen to this. And when Christ, who is your life. It doesn't even matter what comes after that, does it? You can read it if you want. But Christ, who is your life. So whose life is yours anyway? You've been bought at a price. Amen. Right? The precious blood of Jesus has purchased you. You are now a slave of the Lord, and you're not your own anymore. Right? So when Jesus says, I want everything, he should get everything. That's because it's his. He's the possessor of heaven and earth, right? We learned that last week. How does this look? Give your bodies as a living sacrifice. So, physical body, Romans 6:13. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, give yourselves, can someone read me that next word? Out loud, Jessica? Completely. Give yourselves completely to God, for you were dead, but now you have new life. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. So when he says give your body as a living sacrifice, he's talking, let's talk physical first. Every single part of you. Start naming parts, right? Everything from the top of your head to the tips of your fingertips to the bottom of your feet. Every single bit of you should be used not as a tool for evil, but as a tool for good to the glory of God. Every single bit of you. So it's not like, well, I'm doing good with my hands and my feet, but my eyes, man, they're just doing whatever. Right? And so he wants a full body makeover here. Everything should be for him. But that's not limited there, right? You're not limited to this, right? Because inside this part of your body here, there's something inside of here, at least most of you, right? Can I pick on Michael now? He's not here. Oh, I know, but he's not here. Just kidding. I was hoping he's here so I could say that, because we go back and forth. No, he's not there. Now you can pick on him. All right, so listen, mind, right? It's part of your body. This thing, this inside your noggin is this big thing of mush, and there's something going on in there, right? Ephesians 4:23 and 24 says, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, righteous and holy. Romans 12:2, this is just my translation, if you will. Don't copy common culture. Don't just be a fish in the river. Everyone's doing it. This is what we do all the time. I'm going to do like everybody else. He says, don't copy the common culture, but let God change you into a new person by changing the way this thing works right here. And that's by letting the Holy Spirit in to transform who you are by changing the way you think. You change your perspective on everything, you become a different person. Right? It doesn't start with behavior modification that somehow it's going to train your brain. No, you train your brain and then you'll change your behavior. That's the way it works. You can't circumvent the system. So he wants us to change who we are by changing this inside here. So it's really God's looking for a holistic offering, if you will, a full body offering, mind and spirit and soul and body, everything that you are, whoever your name is, Tom, he wants every single bit of you for his use. That's it. Everything. And he'll settle for nothing. That's what he wants. Will he take what you'll give him? Sure. He'll take five little pieces of bread and some fish and turn it into a picnic for 5,000 people. I get it. But what's he looking for? All of you. All of you. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. Listen, Jesus is not some spice that we kind of sprinkle on the main dish so it tastes the way we like it. Jesus is the main dish. Right? He is the main dish. And period. I don't need to add anything to that. He's the main dish. But that's not what people view him as at all. There was a guy, his name is Wilbur Ries. And in 1971, he penned something that became quite famous, but as he scanned the landscape of the Christian church, he wrote something. And it was called, I Want to Buy $3 Worth of God. And this is what it said. I would like to buy $3 worth of God, please. Not enough to explode my soul or disturb my sleep, but enough to equal a cup of warm milk or a snooze in the sunshine. I don't want enough of God to make me love a black man or pick beets with a migrant. I want ecstasy, not transformation. I want the warmth of the womb, not a new birth. I want a pound of the eternal in a paper sack. I would like to buy $3 worth of God, please. Does that hurt? It's most of us, including me most often. There should be a holy discontent in every follower of Christ that it's not enough yet. That my scale is way tipped on God's side. And I've yet to put enough of my life on my side to equal or somehow be thankful for all that he has done for me. And I want to buy $3 worth of God. I see here, I could elaborate on this all night. I see the body of Christ at odds with one another. I see a church leadership. When we were over in Eustis and I'm trying to get these pastors together, the black guys wouldn't meet with the white guys. Look at this. I don't want enough God to make me love a black man or pick beets with a migrant. These are leaders, pastors of black and white churches that will not sit at the table with someone of a different color. You've got to be kidding me. Do you even read the same book? Do you have the same Savior? See, we don't want to be the family of God that can truly come in here on the weekend and go, everything I am for your kingdom's cause. I'd love to do that, but we can't. But would you endeavor to do that? At least would you start the process tonight? That's all I'm asking. We have to put our selfish desires aside. And so then he goes on, he says, then I want you to take up your cross daily. I'm a little ashamed, but I'll just be honest with you that this is the first week I've ever read that. Anyone ever heard of picking up your cross daily? Yeah. Ever heard this, right? It's kind of common, right? And I just never realized that it's kind of weird. He actually told his disciples to do that before he went to the cross. Did it ever dawn on you? It never dawned on me before. He's telling them to pick up their cross. Like for me, I'm thinking, okay, well, Jesus, you went to the cross. I see what you did. So now you're telling me I should. That's awesome because I have hindsight. But these guys didn't. And he's telling them to pick up the cross and follow him. Like, what in the world does that mean? Like for them, like they have to try to figure out what this means then because they don't have what we have, which was to look back on the cross. We can do that, but they couldn't. And so they had to actually figure out what he meant. And so do we really. And so can I offer you this for your consideration, that the cross kills the flesh. Jesus didn't die. His spirit lived. He does not. Jesus never died. His body died. But he didn't die. You ready for an amen?
Amen.
And he's still alive now.
Amen.
Okay. So the cross kills the flesh. The flesh, the flesh, the flesh. The flesh is mentioned countless times in Scripture, and the Bible hardly ever says anything good about the word flesh. Romans 6:19, it says, the weakness of the flesh is impurity and lawlessness. 1 John 2:16 talks about the lusts of the flesh, the things that our body desires to physically please it, and it begins to rule over your thought process, and it's, you become a slave to it. A lust is I have to have this thing. I'm going to go after this thing. No matter who it hurts, I want to have it. I need it. That's lust. That's the flesh. 2 Peter 2:10. It says that the flesh is twisted sexuality, despising authority, it's pride and arrogance. Yeah, not so good, right? Romans 7:25 says, because of the flesh, Paul says, I'm a slave to sin. Romans 7:18, he says, and I know nothing good lives in my flesh. The flesh is the sinful nature of a man or a woman that fights against God and fights against the healthy relationship with God that he so desperately desires. And that's why Paul, being led by the Spirit of God, says in Romans 13:14 to make no provision for the flesh, pleasing its desires. Don't give it, listen. You have to decide, are you going to feed your flesh or are you going to kill it? Are you going to starve your flesh or are you going to gorge your flesh? If whatever you feed, it grows. You put Miracle-Gro in a plant, what happens to it? You put Miracle-Gro on sin and flesh, what happens? You become a slave to it and it starts to dominate the way you think and what you do. And so the sin nature, the flesh, must die. And so to pick up my cross daily means that every day I go to war. Every day I wake up and my Goliath every single day is me, my flesh, my sinful nature. That's my biggest battle every single day. It's a war. You can blame the devil for all the stuff you want, but your biggest task is your own flesh, your desires. And one of our favorite things to do is, oh, it's that woman you gave me, right? Blame the devil. You blame the devil all you want. You need to start looking in the mirror. It's the flesh that you fight daily. Galatians 5:17 says, for the desires of the flesh are against the spirit. You see, they're contrary to the desires of the spirit. And the desires of the spirit are against or contrary to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other. You see the war going on? They're opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. So inside of you, you may have been born again and you want to do right, but there's this battle every single day. And here's where it is, right here. And there's a battle right here in your brain that's trying to fight. The flesh is saying, you should have this, you want that, it would feel so good, you'll never get caught, go do it, you need it, you deserve it. Everyone deserves to feel good and be happy. You only live once. That's what the flesh is screaming at you every day. Anyone, come on, testify, right? I'm not the only one hollering. Every single day, and so there's this battle between the spirit that's been deposited in you that's generally whispering, and the flesh, which is screaming at you, that will feel good. And meanwhile, the spirit's like, yeah, you just shouldn't do that. It's not going to be good for you. If you want all things to work out for the good of those who love me, don't do that. It's the TV, it's the radio, it's the billboards, it's everything screaming at you, and your flesh is eating it up and being fed and strengthened every single day. And meanwhile, there's only one person, his name is Jesus, and he's inside of you going, don't do that. And you got to make a decision of what you're going to follow, who you're going to obey. It's a war. Paul talks about this war in Romans chapter 7 when this amazing man of God, who no doubt has the Spirit of God in him, right? Would anyone disagree with that? He's got the Spirit of God in him, and even him, he's at war. He's like, the things that I should do, I don't do them. And the things I know I shouldn't do, I keep doing them. Who can save me from this miserable life of sin and death? Then it dawns on him, but Jesus. That's what can we do? He's at war every single day. When you're saved, Jesus calls you to join him on his cross, that your flesh would die. Romans 6, verses 5 and 6 state that we've been united with Christ in his death. We are also crucified with him so our sin nature, our flesh, might be destroyed. But listen, crucified doesn't mean dead. Crucified is a process of death. Do you understand this? When they crucified you, they didn't kill you. When they crucified you, they put you on a cross and then you died. It was a process. You put a bullet in someone, here, they're dead. You put them on a cross, they don't die right away. It's a process. So that's why it says, pick up your cross daily. Because you got to keep doing it, and keep doing it, and keep doing it every single day. Never ending, never succeeding, always aspiring and trying. Galatians 2:20, my old self has been crucified with Christ. And then here's the goal. This is what Paul says. Here's the goal. When you get crucified, when you go up on the cross and you die and die and die and die and die over and over and over again, every single day, Lord Jesus, put me on your cross and kill this flesh of mine that's running my life and ruining me. The goal is this. He says, my old self has been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. That's a tall order. Right?
Yes.
It's a huge, tall order. So how do I accomplish this tall order? I mean, he's called you to this super high standard of giving everything that you are to him, from taking everything that you want for yourself that you think you're owed, entitled to, need, my thing, my way, my standard, and throwing that aside. And then going up on Jesus' cross every day to kill that sinful nature so you can be completely like him. How do I accomplish this? No longer living, but Christ living in me. It's daily death. Daily death. Every single day, the process renews and it never ends. If you think you're going to come to the, if I did a call to salvation right now, churchy stuff, and I said, if you want to be saved, you come to the altar right now. If you think that coming right there is going to fix your problem, you're mistaken. That's the beginning of the problem being fixed. That's like the first pill of your penicillin. But if you don't take it all, guess what? You ain't healed. And so you got to finish the medication. And that's what he's talking about right here. You got to finish the medication or else you're never going to be fully healed. Daily death, daily death. Jesus says to be a true follower of him, you have to have a holy discontent about your flesh. Even though I'm better today than I was yesterday, even though I'm so much more like Jesus today than I was 5 years ago, I'm still way, way, way far from the finish line. I'm not there yet. My scale was here. Now, after all these years, I'm here. I got a long way to go. There needs to be a holy discontent inside of you, daily crucified. So how do we do that? And we'll be done. How do we do that? What does daily death look like? Well, as the band returns up to the stage, I want to go give you these three things that you can do. This is what daily death looks like. Are you ready to hear it? Reflection, repentance, and renewal. Three things. Reflection. Where am I failing? Lord, search my heart. where am I failing in this? Where am I selfish? Maybe it's not blatant self-centeredness like that person you thought of when I mentioned it, but maybe there's just something subtle inside of you. Where am I selfish? Where is my sin, Lord? Sniff it out like the bloodhound you are. Tell me where it is. That's reflection. That's looking inward, letting God get in there with a microscope and start looking at your areas, and you're listening. And he starts to point these things out to you. That's reflection. The second step is repentance. Repentance is allowing God to do that and then acknowledging the failure. Nobody likes to acknowledge their failures. I don't like to. Come on now, right? Who likes to acknowledge their failure? I don't like admitting when I'm wrong ever. But repentance means, God, you've come in, you've searched my heart, you know there's a portion of who I am or inside here that is being used for evil and not for good, for the glory of God. And so I want to own that failure. I'm going to own it. Lord, that's what you said. I believe that you're right. I apologize for this sin and failure. I realize that my way is wrong and that your way is right, and I don't want this anymore. And what used to be awesome to me repulses me now, and I don't want that anymore. That's repentance. I want to do it your way. And the last thing is renewal. So I'm in God's word because he pointed something out to me that's a failure, and it's a sin, and self-centeredness, and it's wrong, right? Well, okay, Lord, it's wrong. I apologize. And so now I'm in God's word, and I'm searching for the replacement of my failure. Does that make sense? This is what I was doing, but Lord, there's a different way that you want me to live, and so I'm going to get into your word, and I'm going to read it, and I'm going to study it, and I'm going to meditate on it so that I can find a replacement for the thing that I was doing that was wrong. Let God change you by changing the way you think, right? And so it's this, it's right here. Lord, this is how I should think, and this is how I should talk, and this is how I should live. The instructions of the Lord are perfect, reviving the soul. And so we search out the replacement for our failures. If any of you wants to be my follower, you must turn from your selfish ways, take up your cross daily, and follow me. See, that's a tall order. That's a tall order, and I know it's not a single person in this room that is there yet. Don't feel condemned. I hope that the Spirit of God, using the Word of God, has convicted you to want to soar higher so that you can come to the church someday. Or maybe you're just in your car and that song comes on and you can smile when you sing it, because everything you are is for his kingdom's cause. So maybe you're not there yet, but if you'll commit to this daily process of dying to self, let your flesh die every day. God will meet you there. And he'll do a tremendous work inside of you. And he will create in you the man or the woman that he planned before you were even born. Amen. I thank you, Lord, for your word. I thank you, Lord, that you are bold. I thank you, Lord, that when you spoke with the authority of the fullness of God. I thank you, Lord, that you have been so kind that you would allow us the privilege of still being able to read your word. Thank you for calling us to this very high standard of complete submission to you. Oh, that we could do that. Your word tells us that it's you, Lord, that gives us the will and the desire to do what pleases you. And it would please you if we would give ourselves completely to you and to your purpose and your mission, to put the kingdom of God before anything else, that the building of your church is the most important thing in our life. Let our resources, all of who we are, be poured into that purpose, Lord. That we might be able to sing those words, everything I am for your kingdom's cause. What a mighty God we serve, and what a beautiful church that would be. Lord, never ever let that vision right now that we all have of that church, don't let it leave our mind, Lord. That's the target on our wall right now, and that's what we want to shoot for. Do that work in us here tonight, Lord. Start with us. If you want that, if you want to be the one who God will start this process with, listen, I hope you're praying. You just raise your hand. Just let him know. Just point to him and say, Lord, I want to be that person that commits to that, to at least trying by your strength, Lord, by your power, Lord, by your grace, I'll begin that process so that I can be completely yours. We thank you for this time, Lord. Lord, I pray right now, Lord, that you would help us to man, everything we are, to sing in that way right now. To sing to you with everything we are, completely bold, completely unashamed, to worship you and lift up the name of Jesus and worship you right now. Let our singing be a reflection of the work you've done in our heart this night. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.